When I collect data, I either want to collect data from the whole population or just from a sample of the population. Population doesn't necessarily mean every person in the entire world. If I'm interested in what kind of food should I sell in the tuck shop, then the population is everyone who has access to the tuck shop. Staff, students, parents, but not, for example, the people who go past on the road outside the school. They're not part of the population. The population is everyone of interest. But the problem with asking everyone at the school about the tuck shop is, A, I'm going to get way more data than I can deal with, and of course everyone's got a different opinion, and B, how am I actually going to get hold of every single person at the school? That's quite hard. Doable, but hard. But imagine instead you want to know what kind of food to sell in a new shop at the Hyperdome. Now here's the population. That's not merely hard, it's probably impossible. Why not just ask a smaller group, a sample that represents the population? Of course, that raises the interesting question of how do I choose the sample so that it does in fact represent the whole population? How do I avoid a bias in my results because I asked the wrong people? For example, if I only ask the Year 5 students what they want in the tuck shop, I'm going to end up with a menu full of sugar and who knows what else. It probably won't suit even the much older or younger students, and it certainly won't satisfy the adults at the school or the students' parents. How do I choose a fair, representative sample? We'll come back to these questions in a moment. There are some times when we do talk to the whole population, and that's called a census. For example, the Australian government conducts a census every 5 years. They ask every single person in Australia to fill out a form wherever they're staying that night. And everyone in Australia should be on one of those forms somewhere. That's a census when you ask every person in the population. But if, on the other hand, you only ask some people, who you're going to assume represent everyone, that's a survey. That's the connection between these words. If you're asking just a sample of people, that's a survey. If you ask everyone in the population, that's a census. So let's suppose you're going to conduct a survey. You need to choose suitable questions to get the kind of data you want, and you need to choose a suitable sample who actually represent the greater population. First of all, you can ask basically two kinds of questions. Closed questions are ones where the surveyor decides what answers are allowed. For example, have a look at this survey on the right, which I scanned from a political leaflet I received in my mailbox. The first question there is a closed question. You have to number four boxes from 1 to 4. You have to choose four issues from that list. You can't make your own selection of issues that matter to you. Well, of course, you can. You can write anything you like on the page. Or, of course, you can just pick up the phone and call the politician and have a real conversation about whatever you like. But the survey itself is designed to get you to choose from the set responses only. This is a closed question. But the next question on the survey is open. You can respond in any way you like. For the person who has to analyse the results of the survey, closed questions are much simpler. You just tally up the responses to each option and straight away see where the priorities lie. Open questions, on the other hand, are much harder. You have to sift through the different responses and abstract out the common issues, get a feel for the general kinds of responses people are making. Much more work to analyse. I'm not saying that closed questions are always bad and open questions always better. Sometimes if you ask an open question, people won't know how to respond. Imagine a letterbox survey with the first question just asking, "What four issues concern you most?" and some blank lines to write on. You have to design the survey carefully to make sure you get valid, representative answers without biasing the responses people make. Which brings us to bias. It is possible to bias the results of your survey by the kinds of questions you ask. This is questionnaire bias. For example, the kangaroo is a beloved Australian icon and in some areas numbers are decreasing alarmingly. You wouldn't be in favour of anyone wanting to kill them, would you? As opposed to, in some parts of Australia, there are so many kangaroos that they cause road accidents and prevent planes from landing on airstrips. They can also create unsanitary conditions in parks where children play. You wouldn't object to their numbers being culled, would you? See how the wording of the question and the way it's asked makes you feel inclined to answer in a particular way? Or try this one. Lying to the tax office is a crime. Did you cheat on your last tax return? Like, who's going to say yes? That's questionnaire bias. You can also bias the results by asking the wrong people, or not asking the right people. This is sampling bias, choosing a sample whose views do not accurately represent the population. For example, remember when we asked only the Year 5 students what to put in the tuck shop? Our choice of sample biased the results, because the views of Year 5 students don't accurately represent the views of everyone else at the school. Or suppose you want to find out whether there's community support for a new football field to be built. You could try asking people who turn up at a classical music concert one evening, but you would probably get biased results because they're not necessarily people who would want or use a football field. You have to ask yourself, do these people's views accurately represent the views of the population at large? That political survey has a severe case of sampling bias. Who actually responds to such things? I didn't. I just scanned it to use as an example in my maths lessons. Do I care about these issues? Yes, of course I do. And I vote. But the thing about post back and call this number now surveys is that only certain kinds of people respond to them. And they're often the people with the most extreme views, either extreme in nature or extreme in how strongly held they are. The vast majority of people simply don't bother to reply. Will you really get views that fairly represent the population? Finally, interpretation bias. This works two ways. First, the questions you ask may be misinterpreted by the people you're surveying. For example, you may be using words that have different meanings to certain kinds of people, like asking mathematicians about whether something is fair. Or take the second box on that political survey, tackling local crime in our community. What's crime, vandalism or shoplifting? Or break and enters? Or the Hoons doing burnouts at 2 a.m? Or, to return to an earlier question, tax cheats. They're all crimes. Never mind what local or community mean. But it can also work the other way. Just because 80% of respondents say they care about local crime doesn't mean you know what they want you to do about it. You might interpret that to mean police numbers should be increased, or that laws need to be tightened up and magistrates be more strict. Or alternatively, that laws are cancelled so that those things are no longer crimes. Well, that sounds radical, but it's a perfectly valid interpretation of the results of that survey. You see how these issues are all closely interlinked. What you want is a survey that fairly represents the views of the whole population and whose results have an unambiguous, valid interpretation.